Hello and welcome everybody to another webinar where we interview experts from the field of additive manufacturing or analysis methods to answer all the questions that we received in our material science and additive manufacturing video series. My name is Natalie Rudolph and I'm the business field manager polymer here at Netzsch Analyzing and Testing. A lot of the questions we received were about UV-curable materials, obviously because they really make up a big proportion of the materials used in additive manufacturing and because of the many processes that are based on these materials. I already explained in a couple of videos these processes like Vat photopolymerization, material jetting, binder jetting, and I also talked about thermoanalytical and rheological methods to analyze the curing behavior of these materials. Another very important technology to study the curing behavior is infrared spectroscopy. And one of the leaders in the field is Bruker Optics as a manufacturer of these instruments. And it's a great pleasure that I could win over an expert in that field. Sebastian Ollech from Bruker Optics. He is an application specialist and salesperson at Bruker Optics, and he is absolutely knowledgeable about IR use in curing studies because it's a time-dependent measurement technique, and that's his area of expertise. And I'm also very happy that Sebastian Ollech is here today because we have a strong collaboration with Bruker for many years because together we develop and sell coupled thermal analysis and spectroscopy methods like TGFDIR. And if you have followed the series and you tuned into the 3D printing explained videos, I go into detail what that coupling can do in additive manufacturing. And so you've probably seen one of the Bruker devices on these slides. So Sebastian, thank you very much for joining me today and agreeing to answer some of our questions. Welcome.
Yes, of course. So also welcome from my side. Yeah, thank you to Natalie Rudolph to inviting me to this interview. Yeah. And let's see how we can answer all these questions according to the UV curing measurement.
Yes, thank you. The most basic question is obviously, what is FDIR and what is really behind IR spectroscopy? Can you talk a little bit about that?
Okay, what is FDIR? So we are using IR radiation, so thermal radiation, and we can use this to observe the vibrations in the molecules, so between the functional groups or between the atoms. And we can measure, except of homonuclear diatomics and noble gases, we can measure everything with our FTIR technique. So polymers, for example, these are very good samples for FTIR measurements because most of the absorbance takes place in the IR spectral region. And it's also a good technique because every polymer or every molecule has a fingerprint information with its absorption in the IR region. So we can really distinguish between different samples here. Yeah. And it's a non-destructive technique, so there is no need to destroy your sample. So if we talk about some measurements with some final parts, then you can use it after the measurement, yeah, due to the non-destructive technique. Yeah.
And I think most people know a little bit about polymer analysis or analysis of materials are probably familiar with that fingerprint and identification, yeah, that you said. It's the screening method.
Yeah.
figure out what material you have in front of you. When we think of the UV curable materials, that's really where the material, we start with a liquid, we create a solid, but the material itself that we actually want in our 3D printed part is formed in a chemical reaction. How is FTIR used for that?
So how is FTIR used for that? So we have several time resolved measurement techniques here. So in this example for the UV curable samples, we were using the so-called rapid scan method. That's, so we're measuring with highest time resolution, so we can reach up to a millisecond time regime, so where we collect the data here, and then we monitor how does the molecule or how does the whole sample matrix changes over time. So in this case, if we induce it with UV light, and then we can measure as a background, for example, the state as it is, so the non-cured sample, and then start the time-dependent measurement and see how the bands change in intensity and maybe also sogar in position via these chemical reaction. Then we can really see when does the chemical reaction start and when does it end, and we only have the final product here and no initial product left.
Okay, so the audience would be very interested to learn how you actually perform such a measurement and how you analyze the data, because from what you said, it sounds as if the analysis software is very important, and also knowing how to use it. Could you explain or even show that to us?
Yeah, so I can show it to you. It's better to show it than talk about it. And we have prepared the measurement today for you. We will measure a UV curable sample, and yeah, I prepared everything, and we will see how it goes.
Then we'll follow you to the lab.
Okay, so then let's have a look on what we need to perform a measurement to follow the polymerization process of our UV curable resin. So first of all, you need our research-grade FTIR spectrometers, like the Invenio or the Vertex. So they are a little different in their performance here. So with the Invenio, we can reach a time resolution of up to 20 milliseconds at 16 wave numbers spectral resolution. If you need a higher time resolution for your experiment, no problem. We can use the Vertex 80, which you can see behind me. The Vertex 80 can reach a time resolution of up to 10 milliseconds. So that means in detail, we're collecting 3 milliseconds in new spectra. And these spectra are then stitched together to a 3D file, which we can use to analyze our polymerization process over time. So we can see how long the polymerization process takes place. It's finished. And today we will measure an acrylate adhesive. So acrylates are most common in additive manufacturing, and so it's a perfect sample for our FTIR spectrometers, but we can also use other resins to follow the polymerization process here. What else do we need? So today I will use the Bruker Platinum ATR accessory to measure the polymerization process. This accessory has the big advantage that we need a very small amount of our sample. It's just a drop needed for this measurement. So this ATR accessory has a diamond crystal braced on the top plate here. And this diamond crystal has a dimension of 2 on 2 millimeters. And only this area has to be covered with our sample. But we will see it later in detail. In my setup, I have a standard UV lamp which can be switched on and off manually. So that means I have to manually start the measurement and manually start the UV lamp. So, but our spectrometers are capable of having a more advanced setup here. So if you have a UV lamp which can be triggered, that's perfect for us, because our spectrometers are capable of receiving or sending trigger intents to perfectly synchronize it with our measurement and to have the best reproducibility between each measurement here. And all these things can be set up in the rapid scan measurement function of our overall spectroscopy software. Okay. And how long does a measurement takes place here? So it depends on how long you expect the polymerization process. So for example, with my sample here, I know that the polymerization process takes approximately 40 to 50 seconds until it's finished. So that means that the whole measurement, our spectrometer, will take 60 seconds or 1.5 minutes, because we also want to see how it's increasing, and we want to see also a plateau when it's finished to really prove that nothing changes anymore. Okay, so enough technical things, and now I will show you how to put the sample on it and perform it via our software.
In our Opus spectroscopy software, we are using the RapidScan TRS measurement function. We can enter it by clicking on this icon. So the measurement measure log happens, and behind this test, we can set all the parameters that are needed for this measurement. I have done this prior, so I will not go very deep in detail here. So all parameters can then be saved in a .xpm file. So this is a one-time setup, and after loading it, next time everything is prepared. The most important thing is here the method tab. So we do loop here over 300 counts. So that means we will collect 300 single spectra, which are then stitched together to a 3D file. And with this command, we can also send or receive trigger commands to control the UV lamp. Now I will measure a background without a sample on the accessory. So, and after the background measurement, we put our sample on the ATR accessory. And I will immediately start the rapid scan measure scan first, and then activate the UV lamp. So the first measurement points are without the UV lamp. So we will see how the process starts, and it will see a plateau to really have a nice information that the process has finished and no further reaction does occur. Before we are doing this measurement live, so it will take approximately 70 seconds until measurement is done. And there. Measurement has finished. We can open our result file automatic dedicated window. So the measurement has finished. I need to double click here on the absorbance data block, and now we see this 3D spectra. We can use the red and the blue colored marker to switch to the end position. We can see we have really a difference between the blue and the red spectrum. Now we will use the green colored marker to put it on the band, so it's at approximately 810 So we can nicely see that the magenta colored trace and the green trace are following the intensity of the peak over time. So I will optimize it for a better visibility. And now the green colored marker is on a band at 810 wave numbers. This is represented by a CC double bonded group. And this functional group is decreasing, and the COC connection between all the monomers is increasing. So this is the step for the polymerization. And if we now take a look here, it starts at approximately 5 seconds, and then we reach the plateau, let's say at 50 seconds. So we can count that the whole polymerization process needs 40 seconds until it's finished.
Thanks, Sebastian, for taking us to the lab and showing us in detail how a measurement is performed. Seeing you do it and how you analyzed it raised a couple of questions for myself, and some of them overlap with questions from the audience. The first would be about penetration depths, because we have these droplets in material jetting and the layers in vat photopolymerization, and they have a certain thickness, and they're only a couple of micrometers or thicker. Does that play any role in your measurement, or what's the penetration depths you can reach with your setup?
So the measurement which I have shown today in the lab with the ATR measurement technique, we have a penetration depth into the sample of a few microns. So it's also a wave number dependent, the penetration depth. If the penetration depth is very crucial or important, we can build a setup for transmission measurements and put a defined sample on it with a defined thickness, and then we can measure in transmittance through it and collect the information here.
Ah, okay. So a slightly different setup. Got it. Then when it comes to the speed of printing, the exposure time is very important. The reaction shouldn't take too long, but you want to see how you maybe can adjust it to see what effect that might have. Can you adjust the exposure time in your measurement?
We can adjust it, yeah. If we're using a triggerable UV lamp, then we can control it via these trigger events to turn off or turn on the UV lamp. Yeah.
Okay. Awesome. And then you showed the different bands, and you used your arrows to analyze the different wave numbers and looked at that over time. Is that something that I have to study chemistry for to know exactly what to look for, or what support, what guidelines, what should I know in advance, and what can I just learn from the measurement?
So you should know how the polymerization process works. So what is the process behind it? So for example, in my shown case, it was a CC double bonded connection, which turns into a COC connection. And with this information, we can make a literature search. And there are many band tables for FTIR available, which give you an information on which specific wave number we'll find the defined information here. Yes.
And is that also the change of the band? Is that something that allows us to study the degree of cure? And how do you do that with your software? Can you visualize that in some form?
Yeah, so I've shown it in my example. We have the so-called traces. This was the green and the magenta colored marker. So we set it to the defined position in our spectra. And then he monitors the changes in the intensity. So we can see if the intensity is decreasing, then the whole connections are decreasing. So there are not enough CC double bonded connections available. But on the other hand, the COC bands are increasing due to the connection of the monomers. with it. But we also have the possibility not only to use the intensities, we can only use we can also use the areas under the bands and calculate the traces here to find out how the polymerization process works and when does it start and when does it end and how long is the raising time. Yes.
Okay, so you have double security. You can first study how much of a band vanishes and then
yes.
A new band. Okay, I see. That's helpful. And are there any restrictions in the kind of material you can analyze? Can you only do epoxies? Can you only do, no, you showed actually acrylates. Is there any type of material that wouldn't be possible?
So we can measure all organics, yeah, that's no problem for us. We cannot measure metals because these are high refractive and then we do not get this information out of it. But we can measure all kinds of resins here.
Okay. And then when you just mentioned that during the curing reaction, you see that the bands for one or what the characteristic bands vanish and others appear. Is that also something that can be used when we look at the liquid components? Can we just analyze what different components we have in the resin system that we want to use?
That's possible, yeah. So we have two possibilities here. So we can use the first spectrum, which we collect in our UV curing process, or we do a separate analysis step where we put a droplet of the liquid on and then just measure this one. And we can distinguish almost everything, but it should not be very similar to the main component. And if the matrix is too complex, so too many different components are inside, then it's also hard for us to distinguish because the overlapping bands are increasing with the amount of components inside.
Yeah, and as the resins get more complex, we'll see what chemists come up with. And for the identification, we talked earlier that it's good to know what your material is and what the polymerization will look like, so you know what bands to look for. But if you want to identify a material, is there an easier way to get an idea and hint what to look for?
Yes, of course. We can measure the resin as it is and compare it with our libraries. So we have many, many libraries available with thousands of reference spectra, which then can be compared with my sample spectra and give a estimation on how similar it is to the reference spectra and give an idea, okay, it's an acrylate, it's an polypropylene or anything else, yeah.
Perfect. Thanks for sharing your knowledge on all of that. I'm sure we answered quite a number of the questions that we got from the audience. I hope I represented them all well. But in case people now have more ideas and more specific questions, what's the best way to get in touch with you or other specialists in the different regions of the world if they want to learn more or are interested in that technology?
The easiest way today is now to check out our website. So it's www.bruker.com. Or if you know your local representative from Bruker, you can directly contact him or they can contact you from Netzsch and you will guide the information to us and vice versa. Yeah, these are the channels here.
These are our common channels. it's a well-established collaboration. That's true. So I can also repeat that offer. If you have questions and you want a direct connection, get in touch with us and we'll definitely help you find the right person at Bruker. Sebastian, thank you so much for sharing this information, taking us to the lab. That was exciting, and I think it's very valuable for people who are new to that technology, that maybe just work in additive manufacturing and not so familiar with the materials and the analysis methods, to actually see you handle it and do the analysis. I think I really appreciate it, and I think so will the audience. And with that, I thank you very much for being here today and answering the questions.
Thank you very much for inviting me. It was fun. Thanks.
Great. And then we already mentioned it. You're very welcome to contact us if you have more questions. To the audience, I hope you enjoyed this webinar and you tune in to some of the other webinars, you check out other content, and we're happy to learn from your questions just as much as you learn from our answers. And I hope to see you in the future. Thank you very much, and bye-bye.
Thank you, goodbye.